Custom, contextual, and procedural animation are all features we've seen in big AAA titles that are now more possible than ever in Unity thanks to the animation rigging package. Today, let's start learning all about animation rigging, the animation rigging package, and how we can use it to add procedural animation to our games. And now, let's get started. A classic animation pipeline for Unity game development starts with modeling and texturing a character based on concept art and turnarounds using an external software like Blender. That model then undergoes two processes called rigging and weighting, which build out the skeleton of the model and determine how the model can and should deform. The bones can then be moved, rotated, and keyframed to create new animations. When animations are complete, we can then take the ready-to-be-used character and animations into Unity. This is a tried and true pipeline that has gotten the job done for many years. And if we look at the vast majority of 3D games from the past up to more recent games, it's been used to create most animations. However, there are now a few additional animation options that shake up this pipeline. And the option that we will talk about today is procedural animation. Procedural animation is generated in real time. While standard animation saves the rotation and placement of the character's bones prior to the game running and uses those saved values when the game is being played, procedural animation is able to move bones based on what's happening in the moment and in the environment while the game is running. Now, the extent of how much procedural animation is used will vary between games and its use case. A game like Uncharted uses procedural animation for actions like characters reaching to touch a wall, foot placement, head and arm rotation, and a bunch of smaller details, whereas games like Fall Guys and Gang Beasts are much more noticeably procedurally animated, as their character animation is almost entirely physics-based, which is a form of procedural animation. To be clear, procedural animation isn't exactly new to indie games, or even Unity for that matter. There are asset store packages that allow us to create procedural animation. Unity's Mechanim animation system has offered support for animation layers, animation blending, and inverse kinematics, which can create some similar effects to what we can do with the animation rigging package. And procedural animation can be programmed ourselves using code. So then, what does the animation rigging package actually offer? The answer is a helpful user interface in the Unity editor, a list of constraints that can be used to achieve multiple types of procedural animation, and dynamic rigs. And let's not forget to mention that we can access this package for the low price of free. And bugs have the possibility of being fixed by the Unity team themselves, which is always a benefit. All that sounds pretty good. Now, what exactly are constraints and what are rigs? Remember the animation rigging process mentioned earlier when describing the animation pipeline, building and connecting bones of a model which can then be used to animate the character. But to be more specific, rigging is more than that. It's not only adding the bones, but applying constraints between specific bones. Constraints will determine how bones can be moved and rotated by the animator, and sometimes what happens when the bones are moved. For example, a constraint may be placed on a hand so that when it moves, the arm and shoulder bones move as well, like they do in real life. And rigs are the collections of bones and constraints. A rig might consist of all of the bones and constraints of a model, sometimes referred to as an Uber rig because it houses everything. Or a rig could only focus on specific bones and constraints, just like a single arm. So now, let's get a little hands-on. In Unity, we can download the animation rigging package from the package manager. By using this package, we can essentially move part of the animation pipeline into Unity itself. Here we have Banana Man, an imported character asset from the asset store. The original bone layout and weighting for this character had to be originally done in an external software like Blender, and that is still the case despite the animation rigging package's new features. As mentioned, this package doesn't mean all of the animation pipeline is now in Unity. Rather, specific parts which will make procedural animation easier. But with those original steps of the animation pipeline already complete for this character, we can now use the animation rigging package to render the bones, create brand new keyframed animations, and of course, procedural animations using runtime rigs and constraints. Let's begin. The first step is to attach an animator component to the animated game object. In this case, our character game object, which has the armature as a child. The animation rigging package is built on top of Unity's Mechanim animation system, so in order for it to work, the animator component is required. The animator component allows any game object to be animated, and when combined with an animator controller, can be used to play animation assets in the animator window. The next required component is the rig builder. As we create new rigs for this animated game object, each will be added as a layer to this component's list property. Think of this as the controller for all of the rigs that might be added to a character. Each rig added to the list is to be ordered by priority, but the order must be decided before the game is played. The rig builder interacts with the animator component, which is why it must be added at the same level as the animator component, which again is the parent to the bone hierarchy. This next component is technically optional in the setup process, but will help tremendously with creating animations and working with the animated game object and character model. We are talking about the animation rigging package's bone renderer component, which we attach, again, to the parent game object of the bone hierarchy, same as the animator and rig builder. We can then select all of the bones in the hierarchy window and drag them into the transforms list. A known bug, but you may need to refresh the component for them to show up. Alternatively, if we select the parent game object, the animation rigging drop-down menu has a button that will set up the bone renderer automatically. The remaining properties of the bone renderer allow us to customize the appearance of the stored bones. We can select from three different options for the bone shape, increase or decrease the size, and customize the bone color. Enabling and modifying tripod size will display the local axes of each bone, making it clear how the bone is rotated. The bones are only visible in the scene view, which is where we would want to manipulate the bones anyway. But with it set up, we can more easily create and manipulate rigs. In the context of the animation rigging package, a rig, otherwise known as control rig, is a collection of constraint game objects and the possible source objects of the constraint. Source objects are what the constraint requires to be used properly. To create a rig, we just need to add a new game object as a child of the parent game object that holds the animator and rig builder, and then add the rig component. This is typically the same level as the bone hierarchy, so to be clear, rigs and constraint components are to be used outside of the bone hierarchy, not on the bones themselves. And we can now add this rig to the rig builder as its first layer. But to give this rig functionality, we create a new game object as a child of the rig for each constraint that we'd like to have. Let's add our first constraint. We'll create a new child empty to the rig. Select the animation rigging option in the menu and choose from the list of constraints available. Each constraint has its own set of properties. Now, there are many to cover, and I believe we'll go over them all at some point on this channel. But if you'd like me to make a video of practical uses for each constraint or a specific one, be sure to leave a like and a comment below telling me which you are interested in. For today, let's start with the most basic example by having the character's head turned towards its target. For a better naming convention, we'll rename the rig from rig to target tracking and rename the child to head tracking. Then let's add the multi-aim constraint to head tracking. This constraint rotates the constrained object to the direction of a required target transform. Because we have used the rig renderer, we can much more easily select the head bone. But before we do, let me show you a quick Unity tip. We can right-click on a game object in the hierarchy and press on Properties to open a new inspector window that will never change targets. What this means is that if we are going to be working with a specific game object and its properties, we can now add it as a separate window in the editor. This allows us to much more easily select and drag a game object from the inspector into a property value without worrying about the inspector accidentally changing to the new game object from the hierarchy. Cool. Let's drag the head bone from the hierarchy into the open constrained object property. The only other required component for this constraint to impact our character is to add a source object, aka what we want it to look at. Let's create a new object titled Look at Target, and then drag it into the source object list. moving around the source target, and we'll notice that nothing is happening. This is because constraints only work when the game is running, or when preview mode is active on the animation and timeline window. If we enter play mode, we can now see that if we move around the target, the head follows. You may be wondering what the remaining properties of the multi-aim constraint are for. They determine how the constraint rotation works. Note that other than wait, in order for the changes to take effect, we actually need to restart play mode. Weight is the percentage of influence we want to apply to the constraint object, 1 meaning 100%. The aim axis should be set to the specific axis that we want to point towards the target. For a character, this is most likely going to be Z in Unity. And setting the up axis will determine which axis we want to be rotated toward the upward direction. However, this doesn't do anything without the world up type set. Specifying the world up type will determine which direction the constraint will consider upwards and how the rotation handles rolling. Here is the difference between setting it correctly and not setting it at all. We've seen one source object, but we can also add many more. Playing with the weight slider will determine where the constraint object will rotate. Having multiple at a value of 1 will rotate towards the center point between the source objects. Maintain offset will keep the object in its original rotation until the source object is moved, but will then rotate to follow its movement path. Offset is simply an additional applied rotation to the object. Selecting X, Y, and/or Z of the constrained axes property determines which axes is allowed to rotate in order to look at the target. And min and max limits determine how much rotation can be applied to any of the available axes. For a character, we're looking at about minus 90 and 90 for the min and max values. And that is working procedurally generated head tracking. Part of the beauty of how the rigging package is designed comes from the rig builder and its layers. We can have separate rigs for different situations that the animated game object or character may encounter and activate and deactivate each layer accordingly. We can have a target tracking rig, which has a constraint for the character's head. But we can also have completely separate rigs for things like climbing, which has constraints for the hands and legs to properly position themselves on a wall, or passive interactions, which could have constraints that handle interacting with the environment. The point is, the layout provided to us as developers is super flexible. In the future, we'll take a look at more practical uses of each constraint, discuss some of the limitations of this package, and learn to bake new animations. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss it. Remember, you can grab access to this project's files by supporting the channel over on Patreon, as well as vote on future tutorials, get early access to videos, and more. Thank you to all of the current patrons for the continued support and guidance of this channel, and a special shout out to TaroDev, OneBeats, Jupe, and BlueStrings for the extra support. Hop into the channel Discord if you're interested in joining an awesome growing community of developers just like yourself. But that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.